great, I wish I had somebody, and that he promised your fathers and your grandfathers, and the things that he promised your children that the enemy is trying to attack, because for every day that you are down, the enemy is still working.
Use my phone to call your mom. She says she's stuck somewhere.
For every day that you take a break, the enemy is still working. For every day you don't pray, the enemy is still working. Do you think that the enemy takes a break off of your back? So God is saying this. As we are moving forward as the church, as we are going into a new place, not just a physical building, as we are going forth in God, as it is the enemy's assignment to destroy the church, it's got to be our assignment to build the church. Look at somebody and say, get out your feelings. That's like telling somebody. Look at somebody else because they didn't understand what you're saying. Say, get out your feelings. We saw in our feelings God can't heal us. He can't deliver us. He can't use us. He can't do anything with us. Because we in our feelings. Let me tell you what in your feelings sound like. Pastor, I love you. Pastor, I don't love you. He only loved Mike and Brother Russell, Pastor Lee, and Jamel. You know, people he hang out. That, he don't love you. He ain't going to use you. You ain't anointed. That spiritually immature. I'm going to just call it what it is. You are that spiritually immature. Do you realize how many things I got to do in one day? Look at somebody say, if you want to come chill with me, come chill with me. Ain't that the truth? If I'm at the office, running my business, and you call me and say, Pastor, I want to kick it with you, what I tell you? Maybe I'm busy, but come on to the office. I buy you a pizza. We'll sit around and eat pizza and wings and everything. Ain't nobody exempt from it. What? Are you crazy? But it's the enemy's job to get in our ears about simple stuff. Somebody say, get out your feelings. He didn't let me preach today. I was supposed to preach. Somebody say, get out your feelings. Because all the while we in our feelings, the enemy is ripping the church apart. Y'all ain't talking about it. Y'all don't want to hear nothing. Y'all want to hear God gonna make a way. God gonna give you a house, a car, and land, and all that good stuff. I'm telling you, before he give us houses, cars, and land, we gonna have to get ourselves together as the church. Let me tell you what the church looked like. Give me that box of tissue. It's all right. Just run over there real quick. There's something over there. There's something right over there. This is what the church looked like. We all right. It's fine. We good. The church is being torn apart and ripped apart. And so here's what happens. You got a couple? I just need a couple. Come up here and hold this for me. Thank you. This is good right here. I don't want to wait. So let me show y'all, just give you a quick demonstration of what happened to the church. So on the day of Pentecost, the church, can y'all see this? That's all right. The church was all together. Give me some more. We were all on one accord. We were all in one place. The Holy Ghost was raining and moving, and Peter got up and preached. Wasn't nobody scheduled to preach, he just got up and preached. So the church was all together, and then the church got established under the apostleship of Paul. And then Here came everybody in Azusa Street.
Come on.
Hallelujah. I've heard that's what somebody's doing. At Azusa Street, there was a similar experience that took place. And everybody was on one accord. But then here came the Methodists. And then here came the Baptists. And then here came the Church of God in Christ. Here came the PAW, UCAF, African Methodist Episcopal, CME, the Catholic Church. I ain't even got enough napkins to do it. Unitarians, Scientology,
Jehovah's
Witness, everybody, Hebrew Apostolic, everybody. So now the church done went from being on one accord to everybody reading the same book and having a different opinion. Position.
Come on.
And so the leader's job was to protect the church. But the fact of the matter is that the leaders have destroyed the church. Can't nobody tell your truth like you can. So let me say this. I was a leader that was destroying the church. Church got quiet. Can't nobody tell your truth like you can. When you tell your truth, you shut the devil right up. You shut the devil. You shut. Look, say, shut your mouth. When God pulled me to a place of stability in the spirit, there will come a point in time in your life where you are anointed, and the enemy will take control of you.
Oh, I didn't know I had to ask right there.
God's ready to launch you into the deep, transparent. One time I asked God, I said, God, you know I don't want to walk away. I don't want to do this. I don't want to walk away. God said, so you mean so-and-so's feelings is more important than mine? He said, so you mean to tell me that now you love that more than you love me? And if you really love God, God don't just say stuff like that to you and you don't respond. With you for you to understand that it's a privilege to be where you are.
Thank you, Lord.
This ain't something that you merited. This ain't something that you was able to pull off on your own. You don't look as good as you look because you did it by yourself. Some of us got a little bit of money in our pocket. Now we treat God like, God, I get to you when I get ready. But God said, what you gonna do when I snatch that real bread out of my money? The church. I done made a mess up here, boy. But this is what the church is looking like right about now. But there's a remnant of people. There's a remnant in the earthly realm that says, God, I'm appreciative of what you did for me, how you brought me out, how you pulled me through. I'm appreciative. And there is a church that is willing to unify. Do you realize that you are better together than you are apart? Do you realize that's why we got so many dying churches that ain't growing right now? Because folks don't realize, you know what? Back in the day, you had to wait till your pastor got old and died before you became a pastor. He had to be like 80. And then after he died, somebody else got it. What do I say? I'm not saying that we're not called, we're not anointed. I'm not saying that the church is not going anywhere. I'm just saying as the remnant, you're going to have to work harder. I'm saying that the remnant, they understand how important it is to come into the house of God and do God's business. The remnant don't be on their phone during the message. The remnant come to church on time. The remnant come to church early. The remnant is not a disease to the church. It's a healing to the church. Do you want to be a part of this church? And let me tell you something. Just because this church right here got a big sanctuary, a popular pastor, don't mean it's the church. Uh-oh. A lot of the churches that's really worth going to is the ones that are dying. They just don't know how to keep up with the times. But they got the truth in their belly. So the enemy can pull us away from the truth. And he can pull us away from success. Real success is not in material possessions. We'll get it after church. It's all right. Yeah, it's all right. Real success is not in material possessions. Do you realize there is something on the inside of you that is far beyond what you can buy with money? Far beyond what you can buy with money. It's a privilege to stand in this place, especially if you are a leader in the church. It's a privilege. God has taken us, and this is my last point, and we get ready to get on out of here. God is taking us to a place where our church experience is no longer going to be able to be ruled by our emotions. Y'all hear me? Your church experience is no longer going to be able to be ruled by your emotions. Let me tell you something. When somebody, and I preached a message called Where Do You Stand? When folks is bombing outside your window and it's folks telling you that you can't go to church, you ain't got time for no pretty little praise thing. You ain't gonna have time to prepare. You're gonna have to be able to stir something up on the inside of your stomach that's gonna be able to get the guy out. We get ready to go on a consecration. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We get ready to go on a consecration. Question is a lot of folks don't like consecration, but the problem is those that don't like it probably the ones that did it. Is that right? Because the question is, when is the last time you prayed on your own? When is the last time you fasted on your own in the church wasn't fasting? We just keep on going to Applebee's, McDonald's, we just keep on stuffing our face. Turn that plate down. Sacrifice something for the Lord. See, we're a young church, and God's doing, like I said, God doesn't change. The methods in which he chooses to reveal himself, they change, but he never changes. But there's some foundational things that you ain't never going to be able to change. Fasting and prayer ain't going nowhere. So that's why I said today, I said, I'm going into prayer today at 11 o'clock. I don't care who comes, who don't come. I tried to worry myself about who was coming and what. I said, I ain't begging no Christians to come and pray. I said, when did I have to reduce myself to begging Christians to come and pray? I ain't doing that. For what? For what? And so when folks come to my office and say, my whole house is falling apart, I'm going to say, well, come to prayer this Sunday at 11 o'clock. Either come there or come to intercessory prayer. Because the church don't even pray no more. Since when you got to ask prophets and minstrels and Levites and elders and evangelists? And when since this is the problem with the church, we ought to be the ones standing up saying, okay, everybody, come to prayer. If ain't nobody else there, the leaders, we going to be there. Leaders looking like you trying to front. I'm talking all the way down the church. We the ones that's supposed to be saying, hey, everybody come to prayer. Praise me. We gonna lead folks in worship. We gotta be ready. We gotta be ready. We gotta be prayed up. Well, Pastor, I be praying on the way to church. No, you don't. But here's the thing. When folks think they're going to put on a production, I got to preach. I'm going to be there on time. I got my bag. Woo! Woo! I'm at prayer. I'm so deep. The oil is just dripping from my fingertips. Woo! Pastor's anniversary, they put you over something, you at church on time, how you gonna give me more glory than you give God? You about to get me in trouble. Don't you put me up on no pedestal and then you don't give God glory?